introduce Mike Wright. He has been called a few names over the last three adverts, but it's definitely Mike. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but Mark Wright was sick, so I'm not taking his place. My tight end Wright was born on the 29th of December, 1864, 23 High Street, Rosamedley. One of six children, Edmund, Maggie Ann, Alfred, Charles, John and Rose. His father, Edward, and mother, Mary Ann Moses. Edward was a labourer, and on the marriage certificate, which is at the back, he became a miner. And his father, Thomas, was a miller. And we believe that he worked in Pentry Mill, because their son Charles was born in Brynavellen, which most of you know Brynavellen at the Dark Lane, according to the birth certificate I got for Uncle Charlie at 1876. The family moved around, Strictly St. Rosamedley, Chapel Street, and then on to Burton Terrace in Acrobyre. Tide and his sons were all miners, and they worked at the Winstead Pit, known locally as the Green Pit. It was opened in 1856 and closed in 1927. And at its peak, it employed 1,033 men and boys. According to the records, it's the only pit in Denbighshire that had a royal visit. Queen Victoria, in 1889, toured North Wales, and she stayed at Pally Hall down Llandderfel near Bala. She didn't visit the pit, but her daughter, Princess Alice, went down the pit to see the workings at the coal face. When they had finished the visit, she requested that the management would give them an extra shilling to commemorate that visit, and also the rest of the day off. This pleased the miners immensely, and they all cheered. My tide was married on the 8th of September 1890 at Rosamedley Church to Mary Jane Stacey, who lived at 3 and 4 Brynafonin Road. Her father, Edwin, was a smelter at Coppice Works, and he built the houses where they were living, 3 and 4 Brynafonin Road. Nine was one of seven children. In the 1881 census, there is a copy at the back. The father and mother, Edwin and Sarah, and seven children, also in the house, was the father-in-law, the sister-in-law, the grandson, and two lodgers, 14 in that house on that night in 1881. Tide and Nine started their married life in Rosamedley, where Tide was a lay preacher, and to commemorate their wedding, the congregation presented them with a bookcase to thank him for his help in the three churches. Tide bought the old vicarage on the 19th of September 1895 at an auction in the Black Horse for £140. He paid 10% deposit, which he had to do, and he loaned the rest at 5% interest, which was more than the average mortgage today. They had six children: Simon, Lewis, Mary, Elsie, Maud, and Charlie. Simon the eldest studied hard and went to work in a legal office in Rotherham. We think it was for Llewellyn Kennedy. And for his 21st birthday, Ty bought him a motorbike and sidecar. Ty didn't drive, so Simon took him around to his various meetings at the Corps, the Council. He was a JP, and also he ran the Rational Society, where people paid a penny a week to save for death and sickness benefit. Sadly, Simon contracted TB and died at the age of 30 in 1922. My dad and Auntie Maud, that's Stuart and Edmund's mother, also had TB, but they fully recovered. Excuse me. time needed to get about, so he bought a Chevrolet car, and his daughter Elsie, who was old enough to drive, took him around to his meetings. She also did taxis to Rathen Station and the hospital in Rathen. My father left school at 14, and time found him a job in the co-op because he was a member or something or other, you know, it's like, and he was filling sugar bags at the age of 14. Once 15, he was able to work in the green pit with his father and uncles, Charles and Alf. Dad's job was to hook on the tubs to go down the pit on an endless rope. The pit was having problems in 1926. There was a strike and lack of coal, and it closed in 1927. At this time, Tyne was 62 and his brother Alfred was 52 and my dad was 20. They decided to buy some lorries and they bought a Model T Ford, a Morris Commercial and some Vulcans to supply coal to Penycae and Kevin. Between shifts they put a canvas top on the lorries to take workers to Fine Ale and Black Park. I remember in the winter of 1947 that the heavy snow stopped any deliveries of coal and no bus services. And one snowy night there was a knock on the door and it was Simon Coffin from Wrexham. I don't know whether anybody remembers the coffins from Wrexham. And she wanted a bag of coal and she'd come down on horseback. And my dad said to her, "How will you get it home?" She said, "I'll tie it on the back of the horse," and she walked it home. And it's about, well, 2 miles really to Wrexham from here. People's lives then were very hard. Eric Harris and Bill Duffy, I'm sure some of you will know them as well, were drivers then, and they did the coal round on a Tuesday, Wednesday and Friday, and drove the buses on a Monday, Thursday and Saturday, and Tuesday and Wednesday evenings. My dad sold the coal round in 1953 to Lyle Denby, who now runs the Jones's bus service. The first bus was bought in January 1970, a Rio 20-seater, imported from America by a firm in Pulford, which built a 20-seater body on it. This was the first picture I put on Facebook, and some of you may have tried to put the names on the picture. But I've got all the names now, but we think it was a trip from Salon. The names are, and I'm sure a lot of you will know them, Ivor Jones, Mona Evans, Emlyn Roberts, Sam Owens, Rona Matthews, the Reverend John Lewis, Sam Roberts, Phyllis Evans, Winnie Davis, Brimmel Griffiths, Bessie Jones, Eddie Parry, Stella Jones, Harold Williams, you remember the caretaker from Robin School, and he also lived in Grosvenor somewhere, didn't he, Harold? And his brother Cyril, and Elwyn Davis, it was Malvin Davis, Wilfred Jones, and Bertie Owens. And they were the ones on that picture that I put on the Facebook. The next bus call was a 27-seater Dodge. The original bus service started from Pen y Bryn, Wrexham, Penycae, by Strategic to Wrexham, Mondays, Thursdays and Saturdays, and Wednesdays to Market Day in Oswestry Street. Tuesdays and Fridays, Penycae to Rose. The last bus, 10:30 from Broad Street on a Saturday night, was packed going home from the pictures and the pubs. And by Gracie's shop in the middle of Market Street, six or seven would get on from the railway pub, walking up from the railway pub. And one comes to mind, and I'm sure you remember, Slew Evans, his nickname was Scoggin, and he lived in Brinister. I'm not sure whether his wife was a diner as well. Yeah. Well, he got on the bus, and he would not get off the bus before he pissed all the older passengers. He was a pest, and we had to push him off the bus and send him down the avenue. People had their own bus stops. They would stand by the houses and put their hands out to stop the bus. Very frustrating when you ran late and needed to get to Rose to beat Phillips's, and because they were almost on the same timetable. Rose was very busy then. There were William Thomas, Racy's, the Paul, Davy Roberts and numerous small shops. and the pubs en route from Penycae was the Queen's Head Bridge Street, the Bird in Hand next to Salem, the Cross Keys Eddie and his mother on it, the Black Horse Jim Lewis, the Cross Foxes Idris, and I'm not sure his wife, what was his wife's name?
Matthew May.
May, that's right, like, so thanks very much. Then there was the Red Lion in Pentry, the Anchor, the Straw Thatch, and I think you've had a picture of them, the Royal Oak Store Spitisa, the New Inn where the Birds live, and the Bricklayers and the Wheelwright Arms. The bus service was very busy during the war years, and the fleet expanded. 29-seater coach, 28-seater service bus, and the 27-seater Dodge. Tyne died in October 52, and my dad took over and he bought the first luxury coach. It was a 35-seater Bedford, with a heater, a radio and a mic, ideal for tours, and I'm sure Howard will remember this, JCA 722. At the age of 7, and I'm bragging now, I would pick up the rubbish and empty the ashtrays before going to school. My wife doesn't believe this. Sometimes I was lucky to find money down the back of the seat. It would be halfpenny, a penny, threepence, sixpence, two shillings, a half a crown. If it was half a crown, I was made that week. Now the college fortnight, Blackpool. Weeks, also day tours for 2 weeks. Very busy. Also Chester races, Southport, Shrewsbury shows, Liverpool shopping, Manchester, Blackpool lights, and London weekends. Excuse me then. Now Lizzie Edwards, Winston's mother, some of you know her as well. And Norman Thomas's wife, and I can't think what her name was.
Olive,
that's it. Teddy and Davy's mother would organise day and trip tours and weekends, and some of you remember those. And regularly, we had 3 stones in the aisle for the extra children. And nobody bothered it. Again, there no seat belts, no accidents. It's unbelievable. In 1956, Edmund Newton, you know him, most of you would, he joined the company and he stayed for 10 years. I left school in December 1959, and by January he was driving the car, a 1936 Morris 14, which I have got a picture in the back. I would taxi service to Rwaban and Wrexham Station. And do you remember the electric slot meters people used to have, where they had to put a shilling in? And that was a pest, that was, because people would flag the bus down, the lights up underneath that, have you got a shilling for the slot? And they'd run to the bus, because otherwise there would be no electric. Once 18 I conducted, and they were full most of the time, and very often overloaded. And if you missed the 5:30 coming from work, they would have to wait for an hour until the next bus. I remember Monday, Thursday, Saturday deliveries. I remember Monday and Thursday and Saturday deliveries to the shops in Penycae. What happened was Williams's Port Butchers in Town Hill used to send the delivery driver to meet the 10:25 from King Street. And then we dropped the parcels off in Mrs. Aubrey's, the Royal Oak Store Spitisa, Mrs. Powell's, the spa shop, Bill Duffield's, and Cyril's on top of Annie Ben's yard. No refrigeration, so they had food 3 times a week. We employed Auntie Maud, my mother, Pearl Phillips, Glenbarket, Sybil Clinitha, and Kath Davis, Eddie Whiskey's daughter, from the prefabs as conductors. The business grew, and in 59 and 62 we bought Comet TS3s, 3-cylinder 2-strokes, which had an unusual note. And I remember Fred Price, the drift farm, which is way up from Drydechen. His wife regularly travelled Mondays and Thursdays from Wrexham on the 12:30. And he said that most days he could hear the exhaust note when he was coming up Gutter Hill Road. And it gave him time to drive down to meet his wife at 1 p.m. in Salem Chapel. The winter of 63 was one of the worst in 100 years. It was very cold and frosty, and for weeks the Crosville had all their diesel engines running day and night to make sure they would be okay for the morning. We had to put some heaters under the commons to make sure they would start also. And we had real problems with the fuel because the fuel wasn't as refined as today and it used to freeze in the pipes. But lucky for the commons, the fuel filters were based on top of the engine, so we didn't have that problem. It was the only winter that we bought chains to put on the wheels to keep them going, because the Croswell at that time stopped running at Johnstown because the gutter hill was so icy. And we had a 29 seat with no demisters, and we used to cut old potatoes and smear them on the screen to stop it freezing up so we could see through it. Pentre Hill was another difficult place, and we are indebted really to the Jacksons for ashes and rubbish to help to get us up the hill. Passengers increased in the 60s, and we bought a double-decker N101 77-seater. This avoided duplicates on Saturday afternoons, especially when Wrexham played at home, when there were at least 10,000 regular attendants. One passenger, I've forgotten his name, but I can still see him now, and he's still alive. He regularly got on at Bellingpulliston at 12:30 on a Saturday. The bus was always packed coming from Wrexham at that time, and we had to push him in. He was 20 standing, and he's a regular customer, so you made sure you've shoved him down the aisle. He was clutching a bag. Now, the next stop was Essex on the top of the hill. The bus stopped suddenly. The bag smashed into the people in front, and he had a bag of eggs. Goodness me. The people played hell. There was dribbles down the end, down the other passengers, and he shouted, "Get off! Chuck the idiot off!" But we couldn't do that, because he was a regular customer, so we had to persevere. But I'll tell you one thing, he never ever came on the bus with eggs again. Right, my dad had an accident in 66. The double decker crashed into the King's Head, and maybe one or two of you would remember that. After that, he never drove again, and he retired at 60. John joined us in 1968, and we replaced the double decker with a 747 seat, which I've seen there on the picture, the blue one. And at that time, we decided to go one man bands. Things moved on rapidly. We bought four Volvo coaches, and we had tours abroad, east along the twin town of Wrexham, Paris, Spain, Italy, over Annabelle, and Switzerland. We bought two double deckers, a Dame of Lakeland and a Leyland Atlantean, for school contracts, Asda, Plasmatic, and Brundle. We had seven regular drivers, and some of you would know them. There was Barry Jarvis. Correct me if I'm wrong, Howard, because you would remember better than I. Barry Jarvis, David Pemberton, I know he's passed away now, Mark Lute, Brian Castell, Ray has died as well, hasn't he? Tony Evans, remember Tony from... Yeah. And Barry Jones, we'd stole Barry Jones from Phillips's, if you remember. We also the part-times, Rosie Lloyd, Alan Hayes, Billy Blueline, that's another one to deceased very sadly, Malcolm Wires, and Selwyn Jones. It's nearly finished. I left in 1980, and I continued to run the garage in 2002. John extended the stage carriage to Chester, Connisby, Abergele, and sadly, the opposition beat him, and he finished in 1993. He went to live in Wallingford, Oxford, and started a bus company called Thames Travel to Reading, Oxford, and London. He sold out in 2010 to Go Ahead. He married again and has settled in Wallingford. Thank you all for coming this evening, and I hope I haven't been too boring. I put photos, timetables, etc. on the tables, so if you need any more information, please don't hesitate to ask me. Thank you all very much.